And she's buying the stairway to heaven.
Very interesting start here.
Do you know that song? If you don't, you do now. Hi, welcome back to another amazing episode of The Abundant Life. I'm peacocking today, along with my amazing peacocking husband, and we're here to share the blessings of Abraham.
Well, as Angela said, today we're going to be talking about the blessings of Abraham, and you know, the word has to go forth for you to know what it is that you have, and blessings of Abraham is one of those.
It's deep, too.
So if you never know what's been promised to you in the word, then how to receive those blessings? I don't know about you, but I want to be blessed, and I want everything that God has promised me. And you say, well, the blessings of Abraham, if you blessed Abraham, how do we have that? What does that have to do with us? I mean, we're not old covenant guys. We're new covenant guys.
Right.
We've been redeemed through Jesus Christ, and we've got new promises. But it's very clear in Galatians that we receive Abraham's seed because of Jesus. So we're going to be talking about the blessings. We're going to go step by step. The blessings of Abraham are all listed in Deuteronomy 28, starting in verse 1, and then going to verse 14. But there's also another part of that whole chapter, chapter 28, and it's the curses. It's the curse of the law. And
I don't want any of those. Well, but it's nice that they're listed, because then you know what you're redeemed from, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
And that was the point that I was going to make, is that, you know, one day I was just studying, going through, just declaring the blessings of Abraham over my life, reading through it. It's something that I do every single day. I mean,
right.
There's a couple places that I pretty much I have inside of me that I declare over ourselves, over our family, over our business. Psalms 91, all the protection that's within there. I mean, that was one that I think that we really stood on when COVID first hit. I mean, like when we first heard that it was happening, that when it came out in the news, we were actually teaching finances at church.
Right.
And so that was something I prayed over everybody in there, because everybody was like, what's going on, this whole thing? I didn't even know what the name of it was then. So I just basically was just declaring, when we prayed at the end of that night for them, was just declaring Psalms 91 and 10, that no evil shall befall us, neither shall any plague come near our dwelling. I mean, that's
Amen.
Protection.
Yes.
No plague is going to come near your dwelling. So, you know, that's one I like to declare every day, just from a form of protection, but also the blessings of Abraham, because there's so much in there that we can walk in, but we have to know that. So when I was declaring those one day, the Lord asked me a question. He goes, why don't you ever look at the curses? And I just did what you said. I was like, I don't want to look at the curses. That's not the bad stuff.
I don't want to look at them.
And the thing that is cool with me and with my relationship with God is that He doesn't like tell me, go do this or do that. He'll ask me a question, because we're free will agents. We have a free will to do what we want. We don't have to do anything. I mean, we'd just be robots. So when He said that, why don't you ever read the curses? Then what it does, it sets me up to basically answer the question where He's trying to get me to go as He is leading me. The important part, what I'm trying to point out is this, is that if you don't know the curses, you don't know what you've been redeemed from.
Right.
So when something comes upon you that's part of the curse, if you know that you have a right for that to not be in your life because you've been redeemed from it, then you can say, that is not going to be a part of my life. Just like sickness and disease, it is part of the curse as listed. I encourage you, we're not going to be going through the curses today, but I encourage you to go and to read those, you know, on your own. You know, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Galatians 3:13 through 14 says this, says that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every man that hangs on the tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come upon us through the spirit of faith. I got that in me. You know, it's like, that's something that you really want to get down inside. You want to know that you've been redeemed from that curse of the law.
Right.
So just like we qualify for all the blessings through Jesus, we also are disqualified from the curse because of that.
Exempt.
He became cursed for us, is what that
says
right there. And it was interesting. I wrote some definitions kind of down of what it means to be cursed. And basically what I have here, it's a declaration which dooms someone to fail. You want to read some of the other points there?
So a curse is a declaration which dooms someone to failure. That's horrible when you think about it, right? To destroy, to do away with, cease, terminate, to render idle, unemployed, inactive. Did you hear that? That's under the curse, unemployment. to cause a person or thing to have no further efficiency, to deprive of force, influence, or power.
Yeah, it robs you of all those things.
Yeah. So,
and the blessing, on the flip side, gives you all those things. It gives you power, it gives you force, it gives you all the things.
Gives you employment.
Yes, it gives you, you know, the opportunities to be a part of that blessing. So it's just the opposite. So not only has Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, but he's actually ransomed us based on what the word tells us. Would you read the next one there, 1 Corinthians for us?
Sure, 1 Corinthians 6:20 NLT. God bought you with a high price.
Paid the price. He paid the price for you not only to be redeemed from the curses, but also paid the price to qualify you for the blessings as well, too.
Right.
Can we read the next one, too?
The high price of the blood.
First Peter.
Gosh. 1 Peter 1:18 and 19, New King James Version. Knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot.
It's the blood of Jesus Christ that's paid the price.
Right.
I mean, it's paid the price to qualify us for the blessing, and it's paid the price to redeem us for that. So it's important for us to know that.
Right.
Knowing that it's not about your good works. It's not about you being disqualified because you don't do good works or because of your sin. It's that you have been qualified. You have been paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what gets you these blessings. That's what gets you all the blessings. It is given to you by grace, and we receive it by faith.
Right.
When we talked about that, I think we were talking about the love of God.
Right.
Same thing. Everything is given to us by grace. We don't have to do anything to deserve it except believe. And I heard somebody say this the other day. I'm going to forget exactly what it is, but they said, you know, Christianity's not about change. It's about exchange.
Mm.
And a lot of times,
you
know, I think that sometimes we hear things. It's like, you got to change this, and you can't do this, and you can't do that, and you got to do this. It's like all these things you're like, you can't do, and you got to do, and you got to change all these things, where it's about the exchange. When you start to get that revelation
right.
of that you have all that goodness, that's what will create change in your life. You know, Joseph Prince always says that when you believe right, you live right. You'll act right.
Right.
And that's so powerful, I think. So
right.
knowing the same thing with this is that, you know, it's about the exchange that Christ did for us. It's about the love of God sending Jesus for us to take care of all this for us.
Right.
So as we were talking earlier, just like the curse is all the bad, well, obviously the blessing has all the goodness in it too.
Right.
And so it's important, though, to establish how we're blessed. So you want to read from Genesis 1:28 there for us?
Sure. Genesis 1:28. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful, multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over every living thing.
I love that. Dominion over every living thing. And there's another part that says that we'll have dominion over everything that flies, everything that swims, everything on the land. It's like, we have dominion over everything. I mean, you really need to get that in you. When you know that you're blessed, you have dominion, it's not about who you are as a person, but it's about what's inside of you. It's about
right.
having Christ inside of you, knowing that you're that blessing going someplace to happen because you've been blessed.
And just not allowing those cursings to show their face at your door, because they will come. But you have the power and the dominion to put it back in its place, because once you meditate on the blessings, you know what you've been redeemed from.
Amen. Listen to what Proverbs 10:22, this is how the Amplified says. It says, the blessing of the Lord makes rich, and the Amplified portion is truly rich, and he adds no sorrow with it, neither does toiling increase it. And the reason why I wanted to use that version, it says,
that's so good.
Neither does toiling increase. That means working. That means you're doing something, you trying to do good works or trying to get qualified for your blessing, it ain't gonna do nothing.
Right.
You already blessed. Your good works are not gonna increase your blessing.
Right.
It's not gonna do anything. You are already blessed.
But it doesn't also mean you sit on the couch and do nothing, because the Bible also says that for those who don't work, don't eat. It's like the Lord blessing you with the grace he first gave you. So he first gives you the grace, and then you're able to carry out exceedingly abundantly and above all the rest because of the grace on your life.
Yeah.
So grace empowers you, like we were just talking about, to do all these things.
Well, that's what Paul said. Remember what Paul said? He said, I labor more abundantly than all the rest because of the grace that's on my life.
Yeah.
He gave the credit to, he wasn't saying, I'm the hardest worker out there because of who I am, because I'm a good guy, Paul. He said,
I'm a self-made millionaire.
It's the grace.
Yeah.
It's the grace that allows me to do that, just like what you were saying.
Right.
So just like we were talking earlier, how the curse is like all the bad. The blessing is everything as far as the good. So it means anything that could go right will go right.
Amen. I like that. That'll preach.
Deuteronomy 8:18 says this out of the NLT. It says, remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives you power to be successful in order to fulfill the covenant he confirmed to your ancestors with an oath. So the reason why I want to go through this is that we talked about earlier, it's like, well, how are the blessings of Abraham, how are they mine? Okay, so Christ has redeemed us, we established that. The blessings, you know, we get that through the cross as well too. But this right here says, to fulfill the covenant he confirmed with your ancestors. So Galatians 3:9 says this, those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. That's telling us, like, if we're of faith, then we're along with this. And remember what we talked about earlier, that God cut the covenant with Abraham. So right. How do we then get pulled into that? Well, Galatians 3:29 says, if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seeds and heirs according to the promise.
Amen.
You catch that? It says Christ. It's apostrophe S. It's plural. It's Christ. We are Christ. That's where the word Christian comes from. It's where we get Christians. You know, we are Christ. So if we are Christ, then we are heirs according to what Abraham got. Just like if you were to have a family member who would die and they left you an inheritance, then you would go to the attorney's office and they would do what they call a reading of the will. So mm-hmm. They're going to sit down, they're going to say, okay, here's all the things that you inherit, all this money, all this cars, all this house. So they go through and they read and tell you everything that you've inherited through that. So that's what we're doing with this, with the blessing.
Right.
We're reading the inheritance that's been left to us because we are heirs according to what we've just read.
Right.
Right. Make sense?
Absolutely.
Getting this?
And amen. So, and how do you receive it?
By faith. Just believe.
I believe that. Thank you, Lord. I believe that. That is mine. Thank you, Lord. Abraham's blessings are mine.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And
you
when
just gotta believe it.
Trouble comes, you just keep saying it with your mouth and professing it with your mouth, believing in your heart, professing it with your mouth.
And you know, the Bible says life and death are in the power of the tongue.
And
so
those who
you can speak life, you can speak death. You can speak blessing, you can speak curse. You can speak riches, or you can speak poverty. So you have that power in your mouth, just like
right.
You were saying, making the declaration. So it's important not only just to know it, but also speak it. You got to use it. Use that mouth. Use that power that you have in your mouth. Call those things that be not as though they were.
Right.
I mean, you've got to constantly be working your mouth. But first of all, you have to have inside of you what the word says. I mean, how do you, if you don't have it in you and you don't know it, then how do you confess it?
It's good soil. Good soil. Plant the seed in the good soil so that it produces the fruit. So stay tuned for another episode of The Abundant Life where we take you through all
the blessings of Abraham.
Amen.
You got-